Greetings and welcome to the Introduction to Physical Science. In this lecture, we are going to talk about bonding, and specifically we are going to look at ionic and covalent bonding and how those work as two different ways to bond materials together, to bond different atoms together. So let's go ahead and look at ionic bonding first. When we have ions are formed, as you recall, when an atoms gain or lose electrons. And when this happens, we form a positive ion and a negative ion. The positive ion is called the cation, and the negative ion is called the anion. And when these form together, they are held by ionic bonds. So anything composed of ions is going to be, as you might expect, held together by ionic bonds. And these are going to have specific properties, including that they tend to be brittle. They have very high melting and boiling points, and they dissolve easily in water. So one example of these is sodium chloride, NaCl, that is table salt. And they can be quite, the compounds that are formed are actually quite different than the materials from which they form. So sodium is a metal and chlorine is a gas, but when you put those two together, you form ordinary table salt that can be used. So it's kind of interesting to see how you can put two very different materials together and get something that is completely different from either of those. Now, when we look at how ionic compounds form, it is, for example, we can start off looking at a binary ionic compound, which binary you might expect comes from two elements. It will have a metal, which is the cation, and the non-metal, which is the anion. And those two formed are going to be electrically neutral. So sodium chloride is another one, and the aluminum oxide another one. And those are going to be examples of these. But the formula does not tell us anything about the arrangement of the ions within it. So sodium chloride is not just one sodium atom bonded to a chlorine atom. They're there, but they're not. That's not the whole thing. It actually becomes a whole structure. So that is the average formula, as you may recall. But we may have a whole lattice work of chlorine here in the green and sodium in the purple, and we'll get a whole lattice work of them all bound together, so that they are completely bound, not just an individual pair. So when we talk about water, H2O has one oxygen atom and two hydrogen atoms, and that forms one water molecule. When we have ionic compounds, we do not have that. We're going to have a whole lattice structure where a whole bunch of them are bound together, but there's not just a single sodium chloride molecule. So that's what we mean when we say that the formula does not represent the actual arrangement of the ions. Now, in order to understand these, we can look at the electronic structures as we've studied previously. And if we look at groups 1 and 2, the number of valence electrons is equal to the group number. So in the periodic table, those in group 1 have one valence electron. Those in group 2 will have two valence electrons. Now in groups 13 through 17, the group number will exceed the number of valence electrons by 10. So group 13 would have, subtract 10 from that and get 3. Valence electrons. Group 14 would have 4, and so on up to group 17 having 7. Now that's for the main groups. When we look at the transition metals, usually they form a +2 or +3 cation, and the inner transition metals will usually do a 3+. There are some variations. There are some times where you actually have to look up to see which ones are going to be forming. But we can look at a couple examples of this, and let's look at the electronic configuration for chromium, which is 3+, and zinc, which is 2+. Now, in order to start this, we've got to count the numbers of electrons, and we know that chromium will have 24 electrons in a neutral atom, and zinc will have 30. So we can write out the number of electrons that would fill each shell, working our way through our tables to find what shells would fill first, and stopping when we get the correct number of electrons. So we can count 2, 4, 10, 12, 18. Here we're up to 20. And the 3D would get us up to 30. So this would cover both the chromium at 24 and the zinc at 30. So we can then write out the configuration and what we would get for chromium. We can see here in the top line, and what we'd get for zinc would be down below. And we can write those out either as the entire list, or as we can often do in a shorthand, we can write it as in brackets argon, so saying the electronic configuration of argon, which is the noble gas before this element, and then the additional electrons beyond it. Now, one thing that is interesting with chromium that you may notice is that it is 4s1. You only put one electron in the s shell, whereas you have 5 in the d shell. So you may be questioning, why does one of these d electrons not go in the s shell? Well, when you have 5 electrons in the D shell, you have it half full and you've got a little bit more stability. So this is actually a slightly more stable configuration than if it were 4s2, 3d4. And then the next electron would fill for the next atom would actually fill back in that S shell again. So now what we want to do is subtract 3 electrons from chromium to make it 3+. So we got to subtract 3 electrons here. And from zinc, we want to subtract 2 electrons. And when we do that, we get, and let's just do it in the shorthand now, we will say that zinc is argon with 3d10. So we took away 2 electrons. And remember that in the transition elements, we always take away the s shell first. So these are the 2 that are going to go away first. And since we're only taking away 2, this becomes the configuration for zinc with the positive 2 charge. Now for chromium, we have to take away 3. Same thing, we want to take away the S shell, outer S shell first, so that's 1. But now we have to take away 2 more, so we take away 2 of those 5, leaving us with 3. So it would be the argon configuration and then 3d3. So you have to remember the order in which those electrons are removed or added. Now, we want to look at the anions. We looked at the cations. Let's look at the anions. And these are going to gain enough electrons to fill the s and p orbitals. So the charge is going to be how many electrons are gained. So they want to fill those s or p orbitals. Those are the ones that are going to make it the most stable. So for example, when we look at oxygen, oxygen has a configuration of 1s2, 2s2, 2p4. And what we want to do is we want to get this outer p orbital now filled. So we need to add 2 electrons to fill the p shell. So the charge is going to be negative 2, or oxygen with a 2 minus as a superscript. So we look at what we need to fill an s or p shell, and that will tell us what the charge is going to be. Now we can look at some examples of this. And let's do the configuration for selenium and iodine. And we have them here. We have that selenium will have 34 electrons, while iodine will have 53. And we can write out a whole bunch of electron configurations here. And in fact, write in the number of electrons in the 1s shell through the 5p shell. So we can definitely get enough electrons to fill up through iodine. And if we write those out, we have that selenium goes all the way up to the 4p with 4 electrons in it, and iodine goes up to the 5p with 5 electrons in it. So now we want to figure out the charges, and what we're going to find is that selenium needs 2 electrons. It needs 2 electrons to fill this 4p shell, which will make it 4p6, giving it that stability. Iodine needs 1 more electron to fill its 5p shell, which will bring it to 5p6. So again, we're looking at filling the outer shell, the s or the p orbital, in these to get the anions that we need. So that's looking a little bit about ionic bonds. Let's look at covalent bonds. Now, covalent bonds are, in this case, atoms will actually share electrons. instead of transferring electrons. In an ionic bond, electrons were transferred from one atom to another. In a covalent bond, they are shared. So there are atoms that have the similar tendencies to attract electrons. Now you might look at these and you'll find that atoms or compounds with covalent bonds have lower melting and boiling points than those with ionic bonds. They are softer and often gas or liquid. They are insoluble in water. And they are poor conductors of electricity. So if we look at this, this is pretty much the opposite of things that were formed with ionic bonds. Now, what's happening in this case is that we are not transferring the electrons. We are actually sharing the electrons. So here we look at a hydrogen atom, and as the atoms get closer and closer together, their electrons in their inner shell will overlap. So those two electrons will interact with both nuclei, and they will form closer and closer together. So when they're out here, the energy is much higher, and you get a much lower energy when you get down to a very specific distance, which is actually the distance for the bonding of hydrogen. That'll get you to the minimum amount of energy, which is when the electrons are best being shared. So those electrons are now interacting with both nuclei. So there is an electron for one, an electron for the other, but they are shared. So this electron might be in this orbital sometimes, and this one will be over here. They are sharing those, and that is what bonds them together. So it is not as strong as an ionic bond, but it is still definitely enough to hold these molecules together. Now, when we look at covalent, there's a little bit of a variation here in that we can have if we have the same atoms, then we had hydrogen, then the electrons are equally shared and we have a pure covalent bond. However, different atoms will have more or less affinity for electrons. Some will have a bigger affinity for electrons, some will have lesser. And in this case, the sharing is unequal, and we get what is called a polar covalent bond, meaning that it will have a positive side here and a negative side here. Chlorine has a bigger affinity for the electron than hydrogen in HCl. So that this one side of the molecule will have a slight negative charge, the other will have a slight positive charge. And that means that simply that the electron is spending more time over here on this side and less time over here on the hydrogen side. So more on the chlorine side, less on the hydrogen side. And we can try to demonstrate this and explain this by using the concept of electronegativity. Each atom has an electronegativity, which tells us about its affinity for electrons. So the higher the number, the higher the affinity for the electrons. It is attracting them much more strongly. So something like fluorine here has a very high electronegativity. Other atoms have very small electronegativities. If you note on the left-hand side, you have things that are down to 0.7. So we can have a big variation in electronegativity. They tend to increase to the right in the periodic table, and they tend to decrease downward. So electronegativities decrease as you go down the periodic table and increase as you move to the right. Now we can use this then, and the differences in these electronegativities will then tell us about what type of bond you'll get. Whether you will get a pure covalent, where things are shared exactly, that would be an electronegativity difference of zero. A polar covalent, where they're shared a little bit unequally, or an ionic bond, where they are definitely not shared. So if you have a large difference in electronegativity, then you get an ionic bond. A small difference in electronegativity will give you a covalent bond. So it will tell us, this difference will tell us something about the electronegativity and what type of bond we'll get. Now we can use this table to tell us what we're going to have. A pure covalent is if the difference is less than 0.4. Anything between 0.4 and 1.8 is polar covalent, and if it's greater than 1.8, then it would be an ionic bond. So we can do, let's do a couple of examples with this to finish up. And let's look at the following bonds. Let's look at carbon to carbon, nitrogen to hydrogen, and hydrogen to fluorine. We can look up those electronegativities in a periodic table like the one I showed previously. Carbon's is 2.5, nitrogen 3.0, hydrogen 2.1, and fluorine is 4.0. So we know what those are. And then we can do these in turn. So for carbon, we know that carbon has an electronegativity of 2.5. And we're looking at carbon to carbon. So 2.5 minus 2.5 is 0. And for 0, it is a pure covalent bond. Now, if we look at nitrogen to hydrogen, we have nitrogen was 3. And hydrogen was 2.1. And 3 minus 2.1 gives us 0.9, or a polar covalent bond. And finally, we can look at the last one here, which is hydrogen and fluorine. Well, fluorine will have an electronegativity of 4. Hydrogen has an electronegativity of 2.1. We subtract those, and notice how we're just taking the difference between them. We're not going to look at positive, negative values. You take the larger one minus the smaller one, and in this case, you get a 1.9, which is an ionic bond. So here we looked at one example of each, but you just need to use that electronegativity table to be able to learn what kind of bond any two elements will form. So let's go ahead and finish up with our summary. And what we find is that we looked at ionic and covalent bonds, and in an ionic bond, the electrons are transferred. In a covalent bond, they are shared. And we used the electronegativities to help us determine what type of bond was going to form between any two atoms. So that concludes this lecture on ionic and covalent bonding. We'll be back again next time for another topic in physical science. So until then, have a great day, everyone. And I will see you in class.